We cannot always do what is right, Uriel. There is often a great gulf in the difference between the way things are and the way we believe they should be. Sometimes we must learn to accept the things we cannot change.
No, Lord Admiral. I believe we must endeavor to change the things we cannot accept. It is by striving against that which is perceived as wrong that makes a great warrior.
The warriors of the Adeptus Astartes are led by noble and courageous souls, each exemplifying the virtues of their Primarch and creed of their chapter. No matter the company they command, each captain is revered as a true hero of their kinsmen. Yet despite the innate talent of many such officers, many within their ranks remain skeptical of any warrior who ascends to the rank of company commander should they lack the centuries of experience often required to assume such a role. For today, we shall elucidate a captain of the Ultramarines whose trials in the span of less than a century are enough to stifle any doubt amongst his peers. The captain of the Ultramarines 4th Company, Uriel Ventris. The origins of the young captain of the Ultramarines date back to the year of 876.M41. Born on the world of Calth and raised within an underground farming community, Uriel toiled upon the subterranean fields as soon as he proved capable of walking. Descended from the deceased 1st Company veteran sergeant of the Ultramarines chapter, Lucien Ventris, the storied tales of his last stand during the First Tyrannic War instilled pride within his family. Perishing during the Battle for Macrag, when fighting alongside the legendary chapter master, Marnaeus Calgar, Lucien's gloried sacrifice spurred Uriel to one day fight as an angel of death in the hopes of upholding the gloried name of his family as champions of Ultramar. Recruited into the fold of the chapter at the age of 6, for 5 years, Uriel undertook mental and physical trials within the Aegisilus barracks of Macrag until proven worthy to complete his training within the fortress of Hera. By the age of 13, Uriel had succeeded in his initiation and once installed within the 10th Scout Company of the chapter, swiftly rose to prominence by virtue of his natural talent. By the age of 23, Uriel ascended to the rank of Battle Brother of the 4th Company and bore the emerald green trim of the Defenders of Ultramar with immense pride. His pledge to his family to become an angel of the Emperor achieved, Uriel swore to become the greatest warrior the chapter had ever witnessed. Under the command of Captain Ideus, the young protege learned to master the virtue of practicality over strict doctrine. Unusually for an Ultramarine, Ideus did not adhere to the tome of their Primarch, the Codex Astartes, with the same reverence of his peers. Respected by each and every battle brother of the 4th Company for his flexible tactical acumen, many of his veteran sergeants, including Ventris, stood uneasy with his unorthodox manner. Confiding with his young mentee on several occasions, near the closing of his service as captain of the 4th Company, Ideus imparted the following words to Uriel.
Uriel, you know I respect you, and despite what others say, I believe you will soon command your own company. But you must accept that sometimes it is necessary for us to do things a little differently. Yes, the Codex Astartes teaches us the way of war, but it does not teach the hearts of men. Look around you, see the face of our warriors. Their blood sings with righteousness, and their faith is strong because they have seen me walk through the fire with them, leading them in glorious battle. Is not a little risk to me worth such reward?
Fighting alongside his captain and junior officers, Uriel, as the newly appointed sergeant of the company, saw to the placation of Harrenveth, Balor Crusade, and Battle of Ikar IV. The valiant defense of the industrial world of Ikar IV against the Tyranid menace, earning both Ideus and Ventris the imperial laurel of heroism. Though ill-regarded by few among the chapter, stalwart champions such as Cato Sicarius of the 2nd Company revered Ideus' deeds above his methods. Accompanying his captain to the world of Thracia, The Defenders of Ultramar combated a warband of the Night Lord's Legion. Aided by the Imperial Guard, the 4th Company targeted the planet's bridge network to prevent the traitor Astartes from outflanking and surrounding their ranks. Confronted by the Night Lords at the bridge designated as 2-4, Idaeus commanded his men to hold their ground. Incensed by the mutilation of his slain men, as the Night Lords adorned their corpses upon their advancing tanks, Idaeus charged into the fray. Driving back the Night Lords with unmatched fury, his power sword forged by his own hands carved through the traitor scum. With only 7 men remaining of his company, Idaeus knew that his tenure as captain of the Defenders of Ultramar was at an end. Entrusting his sword to Uriel Ventris, Idaeus commanded his protege to return with his kinsmen before charging through the lines of the Night Lords, armed only with his trusty plasma pistol. As Chaos Raptors surrounded his position, Captain Idaeus detonated the explosive charges at the base of Bridge 2-4, killing several traitors in the blast. His death a great loss to his chapter. Only one man would be a fitting replacement to assume the mantle of 4th Company Captain. For a time, the 4th Company lacked the numbers to return to the front lines of the Ultramarines' many campaigns. With few men to command, Uriel's talents as a warrior would not go unused, and so it was decreed that the lauded veteran sergeant would be seconded to the chamber militant of the Ordo Xenos, the Death Watch. Returning to his chapter, having served with distinction, with the 4th Company now replenished to reasonable battle readiness, Uriel Ventris accepted the position as captain of the Defenders of Ultramar, appointed personally by Chapter Master Kalgar. Tasked with his first mission to quell a rebellion upon the world of Pavonis, little would Uriel know of the scale of how this event would impact his future. Having failed to pay tithes to the Imperium, at first glance, the mining world's raiding by Drukhari seemed an understandable excuse, yet required a representative of the Administratum, Arayo Barzano, to accompany the Ultramarines. Yet as the 4th Company made planetfall, rumors of a mysterious organization known as the Church of Ancient Ways sowed further chaos amongst the populace. The incumbent planetary governor, Mykola Shonai, on the verge of usurpation, the Ultramarines witnessed the Pavonis Senate call for a vote of no confidence against the governor. Despite the political coup and civil unrest, the Ultramarines succeeded in fending off the Dark Eldar's skirmishes. Traversing to the neighboring planet of Salinas IV, survivors of the Drukhari raids informed Uriel of the Eldar's mission to obtain an unknown relic upon the planet's surface. Finding evidence of a removed object of import from within the settlement, Uriel's investigation was cut short by the arrival of a Dark Eldar voidcraft. Drawing from Idaeus' teachings, Uriel alongside his stalwart lieutenant, Pausanias Lysane, and the men under his command boarded the Eldar vessel using a Thunderhawk gunship. Catching the Eldar off guard, the Ultramarines fought their way to the bridge and engaged the Archon, Keshard, in battle. Demolishing a portion of the Archon's face with a shot from his bolt pistol, Uriel wounded the Eldar's arrogant sense of superiority before falling back to the Thunderhawk. Retrieving the artifact and luring the Eldar back to Pavonis, as the Ultramarines made all haste to the planet, the members of the Church of Ancient Ways infiltrated the ranks of the Adeptus Arbites. Opening fire on the civilian populace, the ensuing riot required the intervention of the Ultramarines left in reserve, led by Sergeant Learchus. Capturing the leader responsible for the murder of 4,000 innocent souls, Amel Vedan, little would the Defenders of Ultramar know of the secret alliance made between the industrial cartel leader, Casimir de Valtos, and the Drukhari. With the opening of a webway portal, the Dark Eldar unleashed a horde of clawed fiends to assassinate Governor Shonai and Arayo Barzano. Gunned down by the Ultramarines, tasked with defending the planetary governor, Barzano revealed his true identity as an inquisitor of the Ordo Xenos and divulged his true mission to capture Casimir de Valtos. With the return of Ventris, Barzano examined the strange object which the Drukhari had prized and exclaimed it to be more than 100 million years old, a shard of an ancient space vessel of terrible power. storming the estate of Casimir de Valtos, the presence of several Dark Eldar within proved the guilt of the duplicitous cartel leader. Unable to locate de Valtos, the cunning schemer attacked the palace of Pavonis whilst its defenses were shut down with the aid of the Drukhari's surgeon overlord. Intending to revive the entombed being within Pavonis, known as the Nightbringer, de Valtos's plans, if successful, would prove calamitous, and so Inquisitor Barzano determined Exterminatus to be the only course of action. Convinced by Ventris to allow his men to scour the Tembra Ridge for the location of the Catan Shard, Barzano allowed the Ultramarines a single chance to avert disaster before deploying his planet-killing payload. Whilst the 4th Company carved a path into the depths of the mountains, de Valtos activated the sarcophagus of the Nightbringer. Reviving the Necron Guardians of the Tomb, the deadly Xenos turned their guns on both de Valtos and Ventris's men. As the Nightbringer decapitated de Valtos with its scythe, Uriel charged for the key runes of the sarcophagus and tore them from their housing. Deactivating the Nightbringer and its guardians, Uriel Ventris looked upon the wounded of the battle, including Inquisitor Barzano. Commending the captain of the 4th Company for his efforts, Barzano rest easy, knowing his service to the Emperor had been achieved, requesting that Uriel watch over Pavonis in his absence. Collapsing the tomb with explosives, never again would the ancient being within be roused from slumber. The cartels of Pavonis would be quelled, with the Administratum assuming full sovereignty of Pavonis. Barzano's remains interred within the Governor's Palace as a hero of the planet. Ventris's first mission as captain had been a momentous one, and proved beyond all shadow of a doubt his capability to lead. The blade of a dais broken during the conflict, Uriel resolved to forge a new edge of his own to fit. Following his successful campaign of Pavonis, Ventris's next campaign pitted his forces against the Tyranid Hive splinter fleet, Leviathan. Tasked with the defense of Tarsis Ultra, an imperial world brought into compliance by the Lord of Ultramar himself during the era of the Great Crusade, alone, the 4th Company could not accomplish such a feat. During 999.M41, under direct orders from Marnaeus Kalgar, Ventris journeyed to the homeworld of a long-distant successor chapter of the 13th. Posol, homeworld of the Mortifactors chapter, was in stark contrast to the gloried vistas of Macragge. The Astartes of this superstitious and macabre chapter bore the same oath of their Primarch to protect Tarsis Ultra from invasion, and under the command of Chaplain Astador, pledged an entire company to fight alongside the Defenders of Ultramar. Unnerved by the strange rituals and demeanor of their brother chapter, Uriel's men, though wary of their allies, nonetheless ventured to Tarsis Ultra alongside a contingent of the Death Watch, Tarsan Planetary Defense Forces, 933rd Death Corps of Krieg, and 10th Logris Regiments of the Imperial Guard. Meeting with the vaunted Inquisitor Lord of the Ordo Xenos, Fidus Kripman, the veteran scholar of the workings of the Great Devourer, oversaw the defense of the planet. Combating the Tyranids both in orbit and on land, the Astartes and their mortal allies watched in horror as the consumed biomass of the planet of Barbarous Prime within system fueled the already monstrous numbers of the Xenos invasion. Ordering the next planet in proximity to be destroyed by Exterminatus, the Lord Inquisitor knew all too well that a war of attrition could not be fought, and thus denied the Tyranids more plentiful biomass to fuel their assault. Uriel's ingenuity saw to the Ultramarine strike cruiser, V. Victus, commanded by Admiral Tiberius to destroy several hydrogen plasma refinery plants to slow the Xenos' advance, yet such a victory was only fleeting. Admiral De Corte of the Imperial Navy rallied all available fleet voidcraft to defend Tarsis Ultra as the Tyranids approached. The costly battles to follow denying the Great Devourer further feasts at the cost of countless lives, including Admiral De Corte. This war would be finished on the surface of Tarsis Ultra, and so the Astartes of the Ultramarines, Mortifactors, and Death Watch readied themselves for the onslaught to come. Fortifying the capital city of Erebus, should this crucial hive fall, the Tyranids' victory would be inevitable. Astra Militarum soldiers died in droves, the sky infested with descending bioforms as they blotted out the sun. Under orders from Kripman, Uriel Ventris and the members of the Death Watch captured a lictor, which showed signs of hierarchical command within the hive mind. Its presence months prior to the main advance of the Tyranids, purporting its unaltered DNA. Manufacturing a toxin from the genetic code of the lictor, Kripman's plan to infect the hyper-evolved species with a virus to break down the foundations of their very biological structure could prove crucial in saving the day. Should the Norn Queen of the Hive, responsible for birthing the Hive Fleet, become infected, the Tyranids could theoretically suffer from metabolic overload and so decay throughout their ever-adapting and variating numbers. Uriel's experience as a veteran of the Chamber Militant of the Ordo Xenos proved invaluable when fighting alongside the Death Watch, and alongside his stalwart friend Pausanias and a contingent of the Mortifactors, the Astartes sought out the Norn Queen. Infiltrating the bioship, responsible for birthing new bioforms, Uriel and his men fought the Guardians of the Queen and administered the poison concoction. With the loss of the Norn Queen, the Tyranids tore one another apart, the psychic shockwave of its death driving their number insane with violent fury. Escaping the bioship, Uriel Ventris and his men had seen to the victory of the Imperium this day, yet such a feat was not cause for celebration. Such was the devastation incurred by the Tyranids, the vegetation of Tarsis Ultra was irrevocably damaged, and this would not be the end of the woes of this unfortunate planet. In his haste to defeat the Tyranids, Ventris had abandoned his own men, his pedigree as a Death Watch veteran overriding his duty as a son of Macrag. Enraged at his captain's flagrant dereliction of duty, Sergeant Learchus Abantes reported the desertion and breach of the doctrines of the Codex Astartes to the chapter command with their return to Macrag. Judged accordingly to his crimes, the senior commanders of the Ultramarines deemed only one course of action worthy of cleansing Uriel's record of sin. Advised by First Captain Severus Agaman to waive their rights to defend themselves to prevent more grievous censure, the two Astartes agreed to the terms passed on by Chapter Master Kalgar. Ventris and Pausanias, for their abandonment of their company, were stripped of their rank, armor, and weapons, cast out from the chapter to conduct a death oath. Ordered to seek out a place of dark iron, divined from the visions of Chief Librarian Tigurius, the exiled Astartes ventured forth into the dark corners of the galaxy. Captured by a malevolent entity of the warp, known as the Omphalos Demonium, the being imprisoned within a demon engine offered the Ultramarines a chance at redemption, symbiotic to its own fell intent. Begrudgingly accepting the demon's terms, the two warriors of Ultramar were transported to the lair of the Iron Warriors Legion, deep within the Eye of Terror, Medrengard. Against all odds, the two exiles managed to locate a band of renegade Astartes led by Ardric Varnes, formerly a shadow captain of the Raven Guard, this peculiar Astartes having joined the forces of the Red Corsairs before abandoning their cause and for a time submitting his worship to the god of pleasure, Slaanesh. Attacking the Iron Warriors as a ragtag guerrilla warband, the Ultramarines, though hesitant to ally with such exiles, could not put pride above necessity. During their time fighting the Iron Warriors, Ventris and Pausanias failed to evade capture by the half-breed warsmith, Honsu. Punishing Ventris for his acts of sabotage and harrying of his men, Honsu implanted the exiled captain within the disgusting forms of the so-called Demonculaba within the fortress of Kalangol. Infused with fell arcane powers and suffering untold acts of cruelty in order to birth abominations to reinforce the 4th Legion's ranks, to utter the methods and surgeries required to create such broodmares is best left unspoken to not taint the minds of the Emperor's subjects. Utilizing gene seeds stolen from the world of Hydrocordatus and the demon entity, the Heart of Blood, using living subjects interred within the cursed flesh of such horrors, the skinless forms spawned from such devices hasten the replenishment of the Iron Warriors' ranks. These abominations were the purpose of Uriel and Pausanias' death oath, for to let such affronts to nature live would curse the very concept of decency. Escaping from his despicable fate, Ventris, once reunited with Pausanias, destroyed Kalangol and Honsu's fell laboratory by releasing a cornate demon prince bound within its depths, before it slew the Omphalos Demonium, which had imprisoned it millennia ago. Their task complete, Ventris and Pausanias, during the escape effort, were confronted by the failed experiments of the Demonculaba, the Unfleshed, mutants though terrible to behold, giving praise to the master of mankind, and sought only the love of the Emperor. Retreating from Medrengard, with the intervention of the demon engine now exercised of the Omphalos Demonium, the Ultramarines and Unfleshed mutants ventured as far from the Eye of Terror as was feasible. Yet little did Uriel know that the results of his time within the Demonculaba had borne a specimen of the most heinous kind, to which Warsmith Honsu and his now allied renegade raven, Varnes, began to mentor. Passing through the tides of the warp, the demon engine arrived in orbit of the world of Salinas. Unaware of the troubles befalling the planet below, Ventris and Pausanias investigated the human civilization upon its surface. Uriel's compassion for the unfortunate fate of the Unfleshed, causing him to attempt to find a means to preserve them from those who felt revulsion at their horrific forms, Ventris comforted the childlike creatures by stating that the Emperor loved them, yet they must hide from the sight of the world's inhabitants for a time. Marching to the nearby hive city of Salinas, veteran Astromilitarum soldiers confronted the unarmored giants. Bringing the Astartes to the planetary governor, Leto Barbadon, the former regimental commander of the planet's guard, was gifted the world by right of conquest. In the presence of the ruler of Salinas, Ventris beseeched Barbadon for a means to communicate with Macragg. Their message to Ultramar, intercepted by the Grey Knights observing the planet, the strange appearance of two Astartes bearing no heraldry, nor obvious means of transportation or even mission objective, piqued the suspicion of the elite demon hunters. Arresting Ventris and Pausanias and submitting them to physical, mental, and spiritual trials in order to prove their righteous service to the Emperor, Ventris accepted such torturous methods willingly in order to achieve vindication. Retelling their arduous deeds made on Medrengard, having proven worthy in the eyes of the Grey Knights, Uriel Ventris and Pausanias earned the respect and aid of the Chamber Militant of the Ordo Malleus. Their apparently chance appearance on Salinas, in truth, was caused by a powerful psyker upon the surface of the world. The Grey Knights revealed the purpose of their own vigil as defenders of this otherwise mundane planet. The barriers between Materium and Immaterium surrounding Salinas were peculiarly thin, and during the 37th millennium, the demon prince Usteroth had invaded the world. Banished by the venerable Grey Knight hero, Ignatius, with the victory of the 666th chapter, the veil between realms had further diminished. Stationed within system henceforth, the Grey Knights continued to observe the world for signs of future chaotic incursion. The populace of Salinas already steeped in bloody civil war, the death knell of the casualties of war had fueled a gateway to the warp, which had been further exacerbated with the arrival of the demon engine housing the Ultramarines. Considering exterminatus, the Grey Knights had through bloody toil banished the demonic entities, yet had not found the root cause of this incursion. Returning to the Hive City and finding suits of Astartes warplate belonging to the Sons of Guilliman chapter, these museum curios from their previous campaign to cleanse Salinas of Chaos taint still showed signs of life. Adopting a full suit of power armor to use in the impending battles to come, Ventris swore to return these venerable artifacts to their respective chapter once his trials on Salinas were concluded. Aiding the Grey Knights in combating the clandestine force, orchestrating the outburst of spreading chaos, the Unfleshed of Medrengard proved to be perfect enforcers of the ghosts of Salinas's vengeance. Seeking to kill the survivors of the Guard Regiment, who had butchered tens of thousands of civilians during the Civil War, the orchestrator of such slaughter, Leto Barbadon, must die in order to sate the spirits tethered to this blood-stained world. Alongside Brother Captain Leo Degarius of the Grey Knights, Uriel and Pausanias took to their grim duty to combat the now possessed and transformed Unfleshed. Wounding the Grey Knights during the skirmish, the Lord of the Unfleshed, instilled with the raw grief and anger of the Ghosts of Salinas, rampaged. Yet with the death of the planetary governor, Leto Barbadon, and banishment of the phantoms of the Salinas massacre, sanity returned to the Lord of the Unfleshed. Imprisoned by the Grey Knights, though this pitiful creature had no control of its possession, it believed in its heart that the Emperor hated it for the slaughter it had committed. Consoling the crestfallen Lord of the Unfleshed, Uriel told the unfortunate beast that the Emperor loved him before placing his bolt pistol to the back of his head and pulling the trigger. Returning to Macragge with the aid of the Grey Knights, Ventris and Pausanias had succeeded in accomplishing their death oath. Following interrogation of their deeds by Chief Librarian Varro Tigurius, with their success, the two Astartes were welcomed back to the chapter with pride by Chapter Master Kalgar. Reinstated as the captain of the 4th Company, Ventris hungered for a chance to prove himself worthy of his rank in the eyes of his men. Though Pausanias must take a penitent absence from the company for 100 days by virtue of hiding his affliction of Xenos technology on his augmented arm following the battle with the Nightbringer and Necrons, Ventris ventured back to the site of his first mission as company captain, Pavonis. Adopting the armor of the fallen hero of the storming at the Breach of Corinth, Brother Amadin, the machine spirit within the Ceramite seemed to reach out to Ventris in order to protect another valiant soul of the Ultramarines. Combating the expansion of the Tau Empire, Ventris could not allow this planet to fall, with which he bore the White Rose of Pavonis as a mark of his first campaign as captain. Deploying the entirety of the Defenders of Ultramar against the Tau invasion force, Ventris prevented the Xenos from claiming strategically important hive cities, knowing that should they gain a foothold, they would become difficult to repel. The ethereal of the Tau, Aun Rai, attempting to convert the planetary governor and other officials of Pavonis to join their so-called greater good, its manipulations of members of the Adeptus Arbites caused havoc. Refusing to allow the ethereal to further poison the pious souls of the Imperium citizens, Ventris confronted Aun Rai and presented it an ultimatum. Retreat from the planet or suffer exterminatus. Willing to sacrifice his own life and those of his men, no unclean Xenos would claim this world of the Emperor's domain whilst Uriel drew breath. Cowardly, alike to all Tau at heart, Aun Rai's aspersions of authority crumbled in the presence of this ultramarine hero. For even such a brief account of the Tau's futile efforts to conquer Pavonis is more than they deserve. The second victory of Pavonis removed all doubt in the eyes of many of Uriel's peers. With the passing of 100 cycles, Sergeant Pausanias returned to the fold of the 4th Company, and even Sergeant Learchus had put aside his misgivings of the returned captain. Yet with the Defenders of Ultramar back at full strength, their greatest trial soon lay ahead. Warsmith Honsu's hatred of Ventris had slowly festered, the destruction of his incubation experiments foiled, and his standing with the Iron Warriors Legion damaged. Revenge consumed his waking hours, and with the renegade raven Varness by his side and a horde of his legion, Honsu revealed his secret weapon. The result of Uriel's time within the Demonculaba had created a heretical clone of his body, not just sharing his physical features, but retaining his knowledge of Ultramar and his past campaigns. Using the clone known as the Newborn as a means to circumvent the defense platforms of the Ultramarines, Warsmith Honsu sought an alliance with the contained demon prince, Makar the Reborn, to bolster his forces. Unleashing a virus stolen from the Adeptus Mechanicus upon Tarsis Ultra, the planet liberated from Tyranid oppression by Ventris turned its already ravaged surface into a decayed death world. Deploying assortments of Chaos Cultists, Traitor Marines, Demons, Drukhari Raiders, Krute Mercenaries, and Dark Mechanicum Thralls, this misfit army of zealots and murderers sought to despoil the domains of the Ultramarines. Releasing Makar from its confinement within the Starfort Indomitable, the combined hatred of the Demon Prince and half-breed of the 4th Legion burned brightly. Summoning a demonic army to fight by his side, Makar enacted the invasion of Ultramar during 999.M41. Rallying the entire Ultramarines chapter to defend their territories, Chapter Master Marnaeus Kalgar, with the aid of the Ordo Malleus, Adeptus Mechanicus, planetary defense forces of Ultramar, and even a seconded squadron of the Raven Guard chapter, fended off the invaders across multiple worlds. Confronting Ventris at the birthworld of his nemesis, Calth, under the advisements of Makar, the Warsmith sought to obtain a relic from the tomb of Ventanus. The burial site of the original captain of the Ultramarines Legion's 4th Company, Remus Ventanus had earned the title of Hero of Calth for his defiance against the Wordbearer's Legion. Tasked with destroying Ventanus's tomb and his war gear, the newborn stood in the presence of his genetic forebear. Dueling his loathsome copy, Uriel eliminated the newborn using the weapon interred within the tomb, the Blade of Ventanus, despite incurring an injury to his eye due to an undetonated bolter shell impacting his head. Battling Honsu, Uriel proved unable to match the brutal methods of the Iron Warrior, imbued as he was with his arm of necrodermis metal. Despondent with the Warsmith's actions, Varnes turned on his ally, and in the ensuing clash, the renegade Raven was killed. Knowing Uriel's life to hang in the balance, the long-deceased Remus Ventanus arose from his slumber at the forefront of the enigmatic Legion of the Damned. Casting the Iron Warriors from his sacred resting place, the Prime Captain of the 4th Company could not allow the inheritor of his legacy to die at the hands of such a petty and malevolent foe. Retreating from the battle, Honsu detonated explosive devices within the tomb of Ventanus as a last resort and buried himself beneath the rubble. Imparting Uriel with the true name of Makar the Reborn before the tomb prevented his escape, Remus Ventanus entrusted the Athame dagger and methods to slay the thrice-born of the Wordbearers before returning to his eternal rest. Traveling to the homeworld of Cato Sicarius, Talasar. Though Uriel had never been accepted nor respected by the Knight Champion of Ultramar, he would not allow his fiefdom to be defiled. Arriving within the crucial moments of Marnius Kalgar's assault against the Demon Prince, Uriel uttered the true name of Makar and hurled the Blade of Ventanus to Kalgar. Slaying the thrice-born once and for all, the demonic army and forces of the Warsmith fell back, the final death of their champion too great a loss to salvage victory. Unable to find evidence of Honsu's body within the tomb of Ventanus in the ensuing months of cleansing of his remnant forces, by all accounts, the half-breed remains at large. Yet Uriel's greatest moment of peril and glory had concluded. His intervention in slaying Makar, astonishing yet brief return of the Hero of Calth, and redemption of the renegade Shade Captain of the Raven Guard proved to vindicate Uriel beyond all shadow of a doubt. The realm of Ultramar had been saved, yet with the 41st millennium drawing to a close, the Imperium began its bloody yet glorious resurgence. Rebute Guilliman, Primarch of the Ultramarines, had returned, his revival following Abaddon the Despoiler's 13th Black Crusade, pivotal in casting back the tide of darkness. Though not present during the battle within the Temple of Hera, Ventris's righteous duty as the captain of the Defenders of Ultramar would not be found wanting. Though drained and scarred from his many campaigns, Uriel knew in his heart that to combat the Champions of Chaos, he needed to be stronger than ever. Having lost his eye during his battle with the newborn, the pale blue augmetic replacement, configured by the major biologist Vyankor Lokard, allowed for greater spatial awareness, refined targeting precision, visual capture, and even enhanced visual spectra. Guilliman began his venture to Holy Terror, his need to meet with the Emperor and retrieve the vast armies of Primaris Space Marines housed within the Sol system, of paramount import. Crossing the Rubicon Primaris during the Indomitus Crusade, Uriel's strengthened form befit the noble bearing of this venerated hero of the chapter. As Uriel defeated the Necrons during the Battle of Sycorax during the Indomitus Crusade, meanwhile, the armies of Guilliman recovered long-lost holdouts across the galaxy in the single most glorious counter-effective launched by the Imperium in millennia. At the vanguard of the Plague Wars enacted by the fell demon Primarch, Mortarion, and his Death Guard Legion, despite their valiant struggle of the Ultramarines, without their Primarch at their side, Uriel and his men could not hope to repel the Pale King's advance. Following the Battle of Raukos, under direct orders from Marnius Kalgar, Uriel Ventris located the flagship of the Primarch, the Macragge's Honor, to inform the Lord Commander of the fate of Ultramar. Unleashing the full might of the Indomitas Crusade to face the pawns of Nurgle, Rabute Guilliman commanded the 4th Company to lead the Spear of Espandor counterattack. Witnessing the defeat of Mortarion during the final battle of the Plague Wars, Ventris continues to defend his Genesire's domain to this day, no matter the enemy's threatening to sunder its grandeur. The Tau were beginning to pick themselves up from the ground, and Uriel could almost feel their dismay at the sight of the wrecked dropship. Uriel reached up and removed his helmet, the sounds of the battle raging through the camp surging in volume. He turned to the Tau noble.
Do you understand my language?
The Tau hesitated, and then nodded.
I do, yes.
I am Uriel Ventris of the Ultramarines. Tell me your name.
I am Aunrai, said the Tau.
And you are the leader of this invasion force?
I am the Ethereal of the Burning Star Hunter Coalition.
Then you will end this war,
said Uriel, stepping close and looming over Aunrai.
Now.
Why would I do such a thing? Said Aunrai. My forces are on the verge of overrunning Olzatin, and there is little left to stop us from taking this world.
You will do it, because I will kill you if you do not.
My death matters little, said Aunrai,
but Uriel saw the first chink in the Tau's outward cool. Uriel was no interrogator, but he knew the Tau noble was lying.
Let me tell you what I know,
said Uriel, conscious of the fact that the longer this confrontation went on without resolution, the more men and women would die.
I know this invasion was a gamble for you, and that you need to defeat us quickly. I know that you have not the resources in place to defend this world against a counterattack. A counterattack that I assure you will happen. I know that even if Olzatin has already fallen, the rest of this world will be ashes before we let you have it. You will have to kill every single human on this planet to hold it. And even then, the Imperium will not let you keep it. Forces from neighboring systems are already en route to Pavonis, and you won't have a strong enough grip on this world to keep them at bay.
Latien shouted something angry, but Uriel ignored her. Aunrai's eyes flickered towards Latien, but Uriel waved a hand before the Ethereal's face.
Do not look at her. Look at me, and listen to what I am saying. You have fought well, Aunrai. Your warriors have earned themselves much honor, but you will gain nothing by continuing this fight.
And why is that?
Asked Aunrai, a hint of arrogance in his tone, the same arrogance Uriel had recognized in all his encounters with the Tau in this war.
Because my starship carries weapons that can reduce a world to a barren, airless rock in moments,
said Uriel.
And if you do not order an immediate withdrawal, I will order those weapons deployed.
You are lying, Uriel Ventris of the Ultramarines, sneered Aunrai. Just to prevent us from taking this world, you would see it burn to ash.
In a heartbeat,
said Uriel, surprised to find he actually meant it. How far he had come since his last time on Pavonis. Aunrai saw the truth of his words, and the moment stretched as the sheer bravura of Uriel's demand sank in.
You are a barbarous race, you humans, said the Ethereal. To think we were once like you fills me with shame.
Then you agreed to end the fighting?
Asked Uriel.
If I order a withdrawal, you guarantee the safety of my warriors.
Every one of them,
said Uriel.
I am a man of honor, and I do not lie.
Aunrai shook his head at Uriel's apparent indifference.
You are a doomed culture, Uriel Ventris of the Ultramarines. You thirst for personal gain and glorification while your Imperium rots from within. Such a society cannot, ultimately, survive.
It has survived for 10,000 years since its inception,
pointed Uriel.
Aunrai shook his head. What you have is not survival. It is merely a slow extinction.
Not while warriors of courage and honor stand to defend it,
This has been a tale of the Great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. The long-suffering captain of the Ultramarines 4th Company has often been derided for his youth and inexperience. None among the Astartes can defame the deeds of Uriel, for while many of the Angels of Death have served for centuries in excess of Ventris, none have achieved his vaunted glories, nor endured his grievous struggles. Should you find those around you, envious of your talents, despite your fledgling age, care not for their barbs of jealousy. For deeds alone endure, no matter your seniority, nor origins. So stand proud for what you have achieved, even should you lack the veterancy of your detractors.